when it came out that it was diagnosable syndrome, you went on LinkedIn and you had all these people, these influencers going like, I woke up this morning and I was really burnt out, so I took the morning off and then I went for like a 12-mile run, and that's not burnout. I remember being in meetings and I could see people talking. I could hear that they were talking. No idea what's just been said. I have no idea what actions I'm meant to take. And that was really, really scary. Something that people really need to understand is that stress has a profound impact on the body. We don't really think about stress as a physical illness. We see it as more of a mental illness. In reality, it's actually both. Men are more likely to bury it and go, I don't want to deal with that. But I seem to get a lot more men going like, I'm really not coping and I have no idea what to do. I don't want to tell anyone about it. Can you help me?
Katie Maycock is one of the country's leading voices when it comes to stress, burnout, and anxiety. Her business, Get Your Shit Together, helps individuals and businesses to manage stress and increase productivity. It's estimated that 1 in 9 UK adults feel stress every single day, while 3/4 will have felt overwhelmed or unable to cope at some point during the last year. I'm one of them. And the impact can be catastrophic, with long-term exposure to chronic stress reducing life expectancy by anything from 2 to 20 years. But how do we recognise if we're in chronic stress and heading for burnout? What are the symptoms? And what can we do about it? I'm Paul Sutton, and this is Middleman, the show for midlife men and the people who love them. Katie, you work with professionals on personal wellbeing, whether that's anxiety, stress, burnout. How did you come to be in the UK working in this space in the first place?
So you're asking that because of my accent. I'm very much got an Aussie accent. So it's a bit of a journey, but I think something that has always plagued me as somebody sort of coming up in my career, especially corporate careers and running my businesses and stuff like that, one thing that I really leant on was my ability to work really well under pressure and under really high stress, which to be fair is a massive strength. But the biggest dilemma was I never realized when I sort of tipped over from pressure and started working in a place of stress until it was really, really late. So if you look at my university, I was doing a double degree, and in my final year, I thought it'd be a brilliant idea to set up a business. So I was going to uni full time. I was running a business full time, hiring people, managing people, all in my final year of university.
I mean, that's a lot. That's a lot to take on, right?
I didn't think about it at the time. I was just like, this just seems normal. Like, I didn't really see that I was working around the clock. I just was like, this is really fun and I work really well under pressure. I got given the opportunity to set up my business. I was like, yeah, why not? Like, let's give it a go. And so there was so much in that. But the dilemma was I was also struggling with a lot of stress outside of work. And so what I found was that I was using work and university as a distraction from stuff that was happening in my personal life or things I just didn't want to deal with. I very much came from the household of don't stress about that. Why worry about that? Just like, you know, bury that and you'll be okay. And it's like, well, that's a bad thought. Just file that away and it won't come back, which was never the case. Things got pretty dicey after I made a really terrible decision in my first business, which I will actually probably, looking back now, look at my inability to pay attention, focus, you know, have that attention to detail and make a good quality decision was probably because I was working under so much stress that I actually signed my business over to somebody without even realizing it. I mean, I was young, so I was like 22, 23. So I made a really bad business decision there, obviously walked away from business with absolutely nothing and then ended up very quickly in recruitment, which if anyone's ever worked in recruitment, it's a really fast-paced, high-stress, high-pressured industry. Yeah. And I also entered it 43 years old in Australia, which I love Australia. Sometimes it's a little backwards, though. It is a smidge backwards in certain areas. So I was walking into an office which was very male-dominated, I was 23, but I looked like I was 15. And I mean, I had colleagues that had bets on me on when I was going to quit and how I was never going to make a deal and all that stuff. And you put me in a corner and I will fight my way out. And so that's what I did. But I was also already quite stressed at that point. So after a year of working in corporate recruitment, I burnt out fully and was very unwell for a period of time.
Okay. That's tough. My wife worked in recruitment for a while and hated it. I think kind of like you, it was something that she almost fell into, but really disliked the environment around recruitment and the pressure you're put under as well to hit targets and deadlines for certain, you know, time of the month you got to hit target by, you know, just found it tough.
It's high pressured. Australia, I will say this, because now a lot of my clients in the UK are British recruitment owners. So they own recruitment consultancies. And what I've learned in the UK versus Australia is that the climate of recruitment is vastly different. It feels like the Wild Wild West over here. It does feel like it is moving out of the Wild Wild West into more of a consultative type of role. But in Australia, it was very high pressured, but it was extremely corporate. But the pressure was there. Like, you had to hit target. You had to, you know, I had rolling targets. So I had a certain amount that I had to hit each month. And if you did not hit it that month, whatever was left would roll over into the next month. So your targets would just dramatically increase.
Yep.
So that was really stressful. So you never wanted to fall off, and you really never wanted to take holidays because your target always stayed the same regardless if you're on holidays or not.
Yeah.
And so that's kind of what happened. I burnt out the first time when I was about 25. I'm not going to say it was 100% recruitment. It was definitely my relationship with stress. But, you know, I entered recruitment. I did really, really well. And so it was extremely addictive, because working under stress can be very addictive. And then also when, you know, you've got the high commissions that you can make.
Yes.
So yeah. there was that element to it as well. When I was 25, I burnt out fully for the first time. And I didn't learn much that time, because 8 months later, I was back in recruitment with a promotion, living in Sydney rather than Melbourne, and did the same thing again within 6 months and was extraordinarily unwell. So
you burned out twice within the space of a year, 18 months?
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. What did that do to you?
Many of a thing. I will say, like, I always look at the three key areas, which is like the physical side, the mental side, and the emotional side. So physically, I was just completely tapped out. So the things that I really noticed was that my physical health was an absolute ruin. So I was really struggling with gut health issues. Like, I was not digesting food at all. I was extremely unwell. I couldn't gain weight for the life of me. I was also really struggling with huge amounts of cold sores. I had inflammation throughout my whole body. So I remember one day I woke up and my left hand was three times the size of itself, and I couldn't make a fist for 6 weeks. And there was no reason for it other than I just had huge amounts of inflammation. So that was the physical side. So I was really, really, really physically unwell. And then emotionally, I was really struggling with anxiety, and I didn't really know what that was, because it was in the era of, like, don't let anyone know that you're not coping, hide away from it, don't tell anyone. And it sort of was kind of like, well, of course I'm anxious. It's just who I am. That's kind of how I envisioned. It's like, you know, I'm really highly motivated. I'm really highly driven. Of course, it's going to come with some anxiety. So I kind of like made excuses of why it was there. But then it got really bad when I started having panic attacks every day on the way. So I'd be on the train, I'd have a panic attack, have to get off the train, get back on the train, have another panic attack, get off. It was honestly horrific. Like, that was really, really horrific. And if I wasn't having a panic attack or stressing out, I was so apathetic that I could not care about absolutely anything. I just did not care about myself, work, home, anything like that. But I think the thing that scared me the most was what impacted me mentally. And when I'm talking mentally, I'm talking about my cognitive function.
Okay.
So I went from somebody that was really focused. I could concentrate. I was really, like, action-led, to being able to, like, I remember being in meetings. And I could see people talking. I could hear that they were talking. No idea what's just been said. I have no idea what actions I'm meant to take. No, it was like I couldn't understand it. Same thing with emails. I'd open up my emails, read an email going, I know this is in English, but I have no idea what it's saying. I have no idea how to respond. And that was really, really scary. And also just my memory, like I went from having like a really amazing memory, like a creepily good memory, to genuinely not remembering anything. Like I couldn't remember what I did in the morning. I couldn't remember where I left my keys. I couldn't remember like what day it was. Like it was, and it was really quite, that was really quite scary for me. Like I thought I was losing my mind.
Yeah, yeah.
And so it was just really quite terrifying, and it was really quite scary for me.
It's horrible, isn't it? How did you go from being in that place where you're physically, emotionally, mentally shot, basically, working in recruitment at what, 27, 28 years old, wherever it was, in Australia, to now being in the UK, working as a coach to help people with this sort of stuff? How'd you get from one to the other?
I ended up, during this time, I met my now fiance, and he was somebody that was just traveling the world, teaching English in all different countries. And at that point, I was just like, I'm so not okay that I ended up quitting recruitment. I needed a really chilled out job. And during that time, I started to write books. And this is so weird, but I started writing books for ADHD, because I have ADHD myself. And so I was like writing all these books about ADHD through the life cycle. So like as you're a kid, as you're a teenager, as you're an adult, because, you know, I was burnt out and I needed more projects on my plate. But hey, I did it. But I met him and, you know, he was living in Japan at the time. So I was back and forth from Australia to Japan. And he was like, hey, let's travel the world together. So we did. Ends up in Vancouver. Ends up in another crazy sales role where I was working 18-hour days. And I didn't burn out that time, but I was awfully close. And I just remember thinking, nope, I'm going to break this cycle. I'm not going to do this. And after that, that was around when I was like 30, 31, I realized I cannot be the only person that does this. I cannot be the only person that accidentally chooses to work myself into the ground, and which is just not sustainable. So I ended up going, do you know what? So my first business, I worked as a nutritionist. I was running a nutrition business.
Okay.
And I was like, surely there's a way to bridge what I learned at university. So I've got a degree in nutrition, advanced physiology. So I actually understood what stress did to the body. But I was also like, what can you do about it? So I wanted to figure out how I could bridge everything together. So living in Vancouver, quit that job, ends up in Costa Rica, built the concept of get your shit together. Did a couple of workshops when I was living in Costa Rica with some of the yoga studios. And then I realized, it's not a lot of stressed people in Costa Rica.
They're all on the beach, are they?
On the beach. They're all just, you know, like TK time. Like everything's amazing.
Right.
And so I'm fortunate enough to have dual citizenship for the UK, because I was actually born in the UK, but I grew up in Australia. And my fiance and I were talking, and I just said, look, I really want to make this business a go. I said, I don't want to go back home to Australia. At this stage, I'd left like 5 years prior to that or something like that, maybe 4 years. And he's American, and he's like, I'm at that stage, like, we're not going to the States, because it's just too difficult to get a green card for myself. So I'm like, let's move to the UK. There's a lot of stressed people in the UK. And so we said, give me a year. Let's see what I can do. So we got here. We had $10 in the bank account. I absolutely knew no one. And I was like, I'm going to start talking about what I learned from burnout, what I know, what foundations I put in place for myself that I think other people could resonate with. And I ended up launching Get Your Shit Together, which is the business, and was just sort of kind of went out on LinkedIn going, this is what I do. This is how I support people.
Yep.
And that's how I ended up getting clients. So I kind of merged what I learned from nutrition, what I learned from corporate, and really understanding how stress sort of comes to fruition in our brains and in our bodies, and what that means and what we can do to manage that, and what it actually means to businesses as well. Because at the end of the day, you could be a top performer, or you could have a top performer in your business. And if they're doing what I did, which was just constantly burning out after, you know, anywhere between 12 to 18 months, it's not good for the business. It's not sustainable. You're losing so much money because you're losing good talent.
Yep.
And so that's how it kind of came about. It's kind of, you know, grown into something a little bit different than what I thought it was going to, in a great way. But that's how I got here, and that's how I'm now coaching people and working with organizations and training leaders and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, amazing. Amazing. It sounds to me like you have a very complicated relationship with stress.
Yes.
Personally.
Yeah.
How do you manage that?
It took me years, and I still think I'm learning this, but I mean, the first thing I had to really understand was that anxiety was happening to me. I wasn't an anxious person.
Okay.
Because if you asked me in my 20s, I'd have just said, I've got bifunctioning anxiety, which really doesn't mean anything. It just means, yes, I have anxiety, but I somehow function. But then
right.
all of a sudden stop functioning. And so I really had to dissociate myself from my anxiety and recognize that all those aggressive voices in my head going, you can do more, work harder, you know, pick up the phone, all that kind of stuff, like things that can drive me towards success, but also drove me towards burnout. I had to sort of recognize that there's a line where that's just not healthy. So that was the first thing I really had to understand. After that, I then really had to look at what stress did to my physical health, because I had all the warning signs that I was going to burn out, but I completely ignored them until my body was absolutely riddled with health issues.
Yeah.
And so now it's just recognizing those little symptoms that are sort of building up towards that sort of burnout and stress, and looking at the habits that you can easily slip into. And that's the thing that a lot of people don't really think about. When you're stressed, you will develop bad habits. And it doesn't happen like overnight. It's just like little things like, oh, I'm going to go to bed a little bit later tonight to get that piece of work. I'm going to get up a little bit earlier to like finish that piece of work. Or I'm going to do a little bit on the weekends. Or, you know, you start sacrificing your downtime, things that you need to do for yourself. It's like you stop doing those things. And it's so subtle that when you look back and you're like, I'm completely different than I was 6 months ago, where I had really good routines, really good, healthy lifestyle, all that kind of stuff. And you're like, what am I doing? I can't even get out of bed now. So it's really recognizing the habits and the symptoms. And everyone's going to have different habits and symptoms of stress. And understanding your own reaction to stress is incredibly important. But I had to learn that. And I also had to learn that stress isn't okay fuel for a short period of time. And I really had to better understand the difference between pressure, which is very motivating, which helps increase drive, increase focus, all that kind of jazz, and really start understanding when does that pressure start tipping into stress. And then I created a framework to sort of be able to check in with myself that I now work with like other leaders and other business owners on, to sort of help recognize, okay, actually I've gone from pressure into stress. So these are the things that I can do to sort of push myself back into working well under pressure.
And is that the difference between pressure and stress? I'm assuming that's how you react to pressure. So pressure is an external thing.
It can be external or internal. So you can be internally. So a lot of the people I work with, they put so much pressure on themselves. If they're a business owner, right? Let's put this in context. If you're a business owner, you're going to put so much more pressure on yourself to be successful, whatever that looks like, for whatever reason, right? That can be, you can be intrinsically motivated and have intrinsic pressure. You can also have external pressure, right? We all have external pressure. We've all got to pay our bills. We've all got to pay our mortgages, rent, whatever it is. You know, if you work in sales, you've got external pressures from like targets, all that kind of stuff. So it's being able to figure out how to manage those two. And I would say the intrinsically high pressured people, they're the ones that can be a little bit more difficult to manage, because a lot of the times they've used that intrinsic pressure that can easily flip into stress, usually is what leads them to burnout a lot of the time.
Okay.
Because it's very addictive.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, no, I could see that. When we talk about burnout itself,
okay,
this has only been something that's been recognized for, 10 years? Is it even that long? 5 years.
So it became a diagnosable syndrome in 2019 by the World Health Organization. I will disagree with some of what the World Health Organization says if I absolutely can. They do wonderful work. I'm not going to completely throw them under the bus. But it's they say it's a physical, mental, and emotional exhaustion from prolonged stress. That's a phenomenon that happens in the workplace. I dropped the last part because the only precursor to burnout is prolonged stress. That's it, full stop. There's no, it doesn't just happen in the workplace. It's just be seen in the workplace because it's impacting workplaces. But it is also impacting the human being. You go find a mom who's like, you know, a stay-at-home mom that's having to take care of the kids and run the household, that person's going to burn out a hair off. Burnout. University students, burning out. So it's not just a workplace phenomenon.
How was this treated before it became a recognised syndrome? I mean, was it, oh, you go to the doctor, they say, oh, you're just a bit stressed, off you go.
That's exactly what happened to me. So I was going in, like, we're talking, I had cold sores that was so extreme.
I've seen the pictures that you posted. Yeah.
It was like a quarter of my face. You know, before the age of 24, I'd had the shingles for. None of that's normal. Like, none of that is normal to have. I also had swelling in every single one of my joints. I had inflammation throughout my stomach and they didn't know where the inflammation was coming from. When I was going to the doctors with these health issues, they're like, you're just a bit stressed. Have you tried stressing? I'm like,
have you tried not stressing?
What are you talking about? I'm looking at them like, of course, but in my head at the time, I'm like, of course I'm stressed out. Look at my body. I'm a 25, 26 year old woman. I can barely get out of bed and walk up and downstairs because my joints are so sore. Of course I'm stressed out. But I think there was a lot before that was happening sort of on like, if you're really into the nutrition and the naturopath and the holistic well-being, everyone kind of had a conversation about it. I think there was a massive thing about adrenal fatigue, which isn't a real syndrome, but we would just call that burnout now. To be fair, burnout was originally coined in 1976. It just took the World Health Organization to make it a recognizable syndrome. So we talked about it, but there was nothing really done about it until 2019. And then obviously COVID put a massive spotlight on it.
This is an odd question, but because it's been such a short time, it's been 5 years since this became a recognised syndrome. Do you think that burnout is in danger of being bandied around as a kind of badge of honour, almost like, you know, I burned out, when actually people haven't burned out.
Yes.
They're just a bit stressed.
Yes. So this is something, okay, I'm so glad you brought this up because this is something that is really important for people to understand. A lot of the times, like I remember when burnout became, when it came out that it was a diagnosable syndrome, you went on LinkedIn and you had all these people, all these influencers coming out going like, I woke up this morning and I was really burnt out, so I took the morning off and then I went for like a 12-mile run and now I can work until midnight. I'm like, that's not burnout. That's absolutely not burnout. And I do think there's a lot of misinformation around it. I do think the word is thrown around way too much. And what it's doing is it's taking away from the people that are really needing support with burnout, who really are in a really bad place physically, mentally, and emotionally. And they're not getting the support they need, because what we've got is we've got this massive pendulum sort of swing where we kind of ignored them. It was like, just get on with it. You're fine. Are you sort of like, you know, coming to work with freaking shingles and inflammation and not being able to freaking know your own name, to now just sort of like, oh, I'm really anxious. I think I'm burnt out. So I'm going to take the day off. It's like, it's not like that.
Yeah.
It really is a really detrimental health issue, like a physical mental health issue as well. So I think it's a badge of honor, maybe, but I do think it's a lot. It is, the word is thrown around a little too much.
Yeah. It's something I've been aware of, I suppose, for a couple of years. It seems to be becoming more embedded. Maybe that's it. It's just used casually, which this is obviously not a good thing. So if we're talking about proper burnout now, I've heard you talk about the six sort of stages to burnout. Let's cover those. What's the process to becoming actually burned out? Because the thing is, when people listen to this, and I did the same because I've heard you talk about it, you tend to go, oh yeah, number one, tick, number two, tick. And there's a stage where you go, okay, that I didn't get that far. So let's cover those six stages.
So six stages, I always start off with number one. And a lot of people take burnout as like, it has to always come from a bad stress or something that's perceived as a bad situation. Like you're in a toxic work environment and you're in a toxic situation. And it can be that, but sometimes it can actually be from what number one, which is excitement. So you have got this, you've got to take on a new role, you've taken on a new project, something new has happened and it's very exciting. So you have a lot of energy that you can put towards. So physically, mentally, and emotionally, you're raring to go. Everything's amazing. What happens at this stage is you start to then fall into those bad habits that I was talking about. So maybe you're not getting enough sleep. Maybe you've stopped exercising. Maybe you're not having as much downtime. Maybe you're not being as strict family time, things like that. So you're sort of all in on this project and you kind of might hear yourself say, oh, do you know what? It's really busy right now, but you know, next week I'll get back to it. Like next week I'll start, you know, I'll take a bit more time off, and it never happens because you've created an unsustainable foundation to work. So then you kind of get to stage two. So stage two is what I call working harder. So stage one, things are kind of effortless. Like, you know, when you're really focused, you're really energized, kind of jumping out of bed, everything's really good. Phase two isn't quite like that. You're having to physically, mentally, and emotionally having more effort in to get the same results that you were getting in stage one that were coming a bit more effortless.
Okay.
But the dilemma is that you've created that unsustainable foundation that it's just you can't work from a prolonged period of time. So at this stage, only you're noticing that just sort of extra mental and emotional and physical effort that you're having to put into. No one else is really going to notice. Your performance is still up there. It's still going, you know, you're still achieving what you want to achieve.
At this stage, do you think this qualifies as feeling stressed?
I think you're feeling a little bit, you're starting to lack a resource, right? You're starting to lack a bit of energy. So you've probably put yourself under really strong time restraint. So you're just starting to lack a little bit of that energy, which I would say you've gone from pressure into stress.
Yeah, okay.
And so you might not be feeling stress, like that extreme overwhelm, right? Like stress is on a scale. Like you can I'm a little bit stressed out because I've got whatever it is. Like I just need a good night's sleep because I didn't have a good night's sleep because of whatever reason I'm feeling stressed out today. I'm so overwhelmed I can't even get to sleep. You know, there's all these different stages. So it's a scale. What happens then is you go into stage three, which is frustration. So this is when the emotional sort of drain is really hitting you. So maybe you've gone from somebody who's cool, calm and collected to being quite frustrated, easier to anger. You're snapping a little bit quicker than you would normally. Or on the other side, you might be somebody that was very outgoing, very ambitious, very bubbly, who is now being a bit more withdrawn. What's going to happen at this stage is people are going to start to notice a behavioral change in you. So that can happen at home, so from family members. It's also going to happen at work. So maybe your performance is starting to dip. Maybe you're not as engaged as you used to be. People are going to start to recognize that something's not quite right. This is when people will start to go, I'm really stressed out. And then some people will label this stage as burnout because they're starting to feel a smidge overwhelmed, but they're not completely overwhelmed. They're just starting to get slightly irritated and a bit stressed out.
Yeah, and I think, bearing in mind the audience for this particular show, will recognise things in this stage.
Yeah.
The grumpy old man thing, you know, the wife saying, sort your shit out, all that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
Fed up with work, lacking drive. And this all falls into this sort of area, I think.
And I think it's, you know, you lack drive, but there's also this desire to keep wanting to keep achieving, right? You're like, I don't have the energy, but I want to. And you're desperately trying to get back to when you were at stage one, where you were really like, you know, wide-eyed and bushy-tailed.
Yeah.
The dilemma with that is people keep that, so they put more pressure on themselves. Or if you work in an organization and maybe you've got targets and deadlines, maybe you're starting to miss them. This is the biggest problem with organizations when it comes to stress and burnout, is that when someone starts to underperform, instead of understanding why they're underperforming and breaking down, actually, I just created a really unsustainable foundation. I actually can't work like 18-hour days because it's just not humanly feasible to do that.
Yep.
What happens is they get that external pressure when they start to going like, you know, get your shit together, like get yourself sorted, like go back to where you were before. And it's like, but they can't do it because they don't have the resources to keep doing it.
Do you see a difference between people who work for companies and people who perhaps work for themselves, individuals?
Yes.
In what way?
Individuals that run their own businesses will wait until they've probably gone past burnout to recognize they have a problem. The people that work in organizations might recognize that they're burnt out a bit quicker.
Okay.
Because it's a hard one. Because sometimes what happens, and I'm going to be really careful how I say this, because I'm not saying everyone is like this, but because burnout is so spoken about, I think when it comes to an organization, if you don't love what you do, and I'm not saying that you will only burn out if you don't love what you do, you will absolutely burn out if you,
yep,
you're more likely to burn out fully and go past burnout if you love what you do and you keep doing it. But I think when there's a disengagement, a disenfranchisement, and you're working in a toxic environment and you really hate your job, and the pressure is so extreme, I think people will sort of, they won't tolerate the stress as if it was in your own business.
Yeah, that makes sense.
I have to be very careful how to say it because I don't want to brand people who are working in organizations as just making up. They're not. They are still stressed out. They're still burnt out. But the dilemma when they work in an environment that's an organization, it's easy to make it the organization 100% responsibility.
Okay, interesting.
Yeah.
Stage four.
Yeah, okay. So once you got into that stage, and if nothing changes, you then go into stage four, which is what we would call illness and anxiety. So this is when your body is going to let you know, hey, you need to stop because you were, you know, you've pushed yourself too far. Something that people really need to understand is that stress has a profound impact on the body. I think there's this element where we don't really think about stress as a physical illness. We see it as more of a mental illness. In reality, it's actually both, but it's more of a physical issue than it is a mental issue. If you actually break down stress and, you know, the fight or flight response, it's an automatic physiological response. So physiological means physical response to a perception of stress. So it does really tie into both. And it really does have that profound impact on the body. And we got, you can see anything from gut health issues. I mean, that's my background. I was a nutritionist and gut health specialist for a long period of time. But you can also see in like skin issues, so like psoriasis, we're seeing a huge influx of things like fibromyalgia, a lot of other illnesses that we've never really seen before that are coming to the forefront. We're seeing a lot of autoimmune illnesses that are, you know, increasing dramatically. We're seeing things like allergies and tolerances. We're seeing huge amounts of inflammation. But if you think about it just from the old school way of thinking about it, you know, when we grew up, it was like, oh, if you're stressed out, you know, and you're a man, you're going to have a heart attack when you're 40 or 50. That was kind of what was thrown around. But that's what we're kind of talking about here. That inflammation that you get from stress is what's going to cause that heart attack and that, you know, out of nowhere heart attack when you were quite young at 40 and 50, which was kind of normalized. But that's what we're sort of talking about with the physical health issues.
I had a thing going back a couple of years now. It's interesting because when you talk about burnout, I hadn't reached the latter stages of this. I'd probably reached this sort of stage. But I had, I was going through a rough time with work, just having to do a lot. I was very busy. I'm a consultant, so I'm working for myself. But I had this breakouts on my hands, just almost like hives, just itchy lumps. And I was like, what the fuck's going on with this? And I couldn't work it out. But it was only afterwards I kind of put two and two together and went, oh, you know. But I mean, there was no diagnosis or anything. It was just an assumption on my part, down to stress. I had this physical, you know, symptom.
I mean, that's the thing. I think a lot of people forget these physical symptoms. And when these physical symptoms sort of come up, they then go, oh, I have something wrong with me. So they go to the doctors and the doctors are like, I don't really know what's wrong with you. Your blood's fine. Yeah. Everything checks out. Like, just stress less. Like, as for the first right? But yeah, so there's, I mean, it really does take a toll on your body. Like, it really takes a toll. And the other side of that is, this is when anxiety starts to kick in. It's like, you've been working under stress for a really long period of time. You've really gone from that pressure into that stress. So stage one, pressure, stage two, stress. And then it just keeps going and you keep lacking those resources. And we can talk about those resources in a sec. But this is when the anxiety sort of hits in. You're so overwhelmed. You're really struggling to sort of concentrate, trying to get stuff done. And you're probably still trying to put more pressure on yourself because like pressure is going to equal sort of outcome. And it really doesn't work that way. But a lot of people at this stage will struggle with anxiety, potentially panic attacks, things like that. So stage four is pretty, you're very, very close to like completely burning out. I would actually say when we get to stage five is when things sort of, is when like we are pretty much there.
With stress and anxiety, I can't really get my head around this. I should be able to intellectually, but I can't. The way I think about these two is that stress is linked to something you can do something about. In other words, I don't know, next week, for example, I'm speaking at a conference, okay? Mm-hmm. So I know that I'm going to have a bit of pressure leading up to that to learn my presentation. On the day, I'm going to be a bit, it is going to be anxiety, but stressed about doing that thing. Soon as I'm up on that stage and I've done the thing, it's gone. All the stress, gone.
Mm-hmm.
That's the way I think about it. Anxiety, I find it hard to link that to something. It's just a generalized feeling of being uncomfortable and nervous. And is that correct, or is that totally off the mark?
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use the same example that you've used. So you're going to do your conference next week. You're feeling a bit pressured right now. You've got a bit of stress right now. Once you're on stage and it's all done and dusted, that perceived threat, that perceived pressure, that pressure is then removed and then you get calmed down. Anxiety is once that perceived threat, that perceived pressure, whatever it is, has been removed, you're still feeling the same.
Okay.
So there's no, you really don't know what it is, but there is this underlying feeling of stress, but there's nothing directly in front of you that you can, that there's no perceived threat that you can see. Now, that's not to say you can't find something. So if you've ever suffered from generalized anxiety like I have, there are just days where you just wake up and you're like, I'm anxious. There's absolutely no reason for me to be anxious. There's no rhyme or reason for it. It's just there's an underlying anxiety that sits with you. And I always talk about being in the driver's seat with anxiety. Sometimes my anxiety is on the passenger seat. Sometimes it's in the back. Sometimes it's in the boot. There's all different ways to look at it. What I really try to prevent is again, letting anxiety in the driver's seat. Because once anxiety is in the driver's seat, you will find reasons to be anxious that you don't really need to be stressed about, but you can definitely make, this could happen or that could happen. So that's sort of how I've always perceived anxiety. It's the same physical reaction that you're having to that stressful situation. And obviously it can be dialed up and dialed down.
Yeah.
But there's no rhyme or reason for it. And I think there's a person called Brené Brown. I absolutely love Brené Brown. She's fantastic. Yep. And she talks about stress and anxiety as a state or a trait. And, you know, the trait would be that sort of kind of generalized anxiety. It's kind of there. You're more naturally an anxious person, which I hate saying because it kind of feels like you can't ever get rid of it, but you can. Well, you can manage it more effectively. Like I still struggle with anxiety to this day, but it's not anywhere near as bad as it was. I can now see it for what it is. And I'm like, oh, it's just my anxiety. Like,
okay.
Righto, let's not like buy whatever it's selling me. Let's just.
And it must be very difficult beyond the stage you're at, where you've come to acknowledge it, not to lean into that, you know?
So we've all got a self-talk. We've all got, you know, we've all got that voice in our head. You're not crazy if you've got it. We've all got that voice in our head. What I started to understand was that voice in my head isn't me. It's just my brain giving me information that I can choose to acknowledge, I can choose to buy, I can choose to believe. What I choose to believe now, and I know it's very simple me saying this, but this is taking me years to get to this point. So if you're listening to this, this might not resonate with you, but I promise you, hopefully one day will. I choose to only believe the positive things. So I hear the negative self-chatter. I hear the aggressive, which is usually my anxiety. Like, well, what if this bad thing happens? Like, you're a terrible person. Like, that person hates you. Like, I have all of those, but I'm just like, I'm not going to believe that because what is that? That's not serving me. That's keeping me in a really negative, stressed out space. Whereas I would choose to believe the more positive stuff. Like,
yeah.
Well, like, I mean, obviously within like reason, like obviously there's I'm not perfect. Like, I definitely make mistakes, but I don't beat myself up about it. And I don't allow it to what I would call hijack me. I sort of more look at it as like, yeah, I made a mistake. That wasn't great. What can you do about it? Okay, fix it and then move on. And hopefully it'll turn to a cringe moment where you're like, you know, not 5 years, I don't think, well, that's a thing, you know what I mean? But I think that's something that a lot of people need to understand. There is a difference between stress and anxiety. And anxiety is one of those things where it can happen when you've been stressed. It's like a frayed nerve, right? You're so frayed because you've been under so much stress. You're so overwhelmed that it's kind of like you're waiting for the other shoe to drop. I work with a lot of clients, and the one thing that they always say to me, once we start getting their stress and anxiety managed, they then become anxious waiting for something to happen.
Yeah.
So it's like they can't even, I had that for years. It was like, okay, everything's really good, but I didn't trust that. But like, because my brain was like on such high alert that, you know, it was so dangerous and it was so impactful. But now when you can kind of like take a step back, I'm like, just embrace the good. There will always be a good and a bad day. That's okay. You've got the resources you need to solve that. So yeah.
Do you think stress leads to anxiety, or are they completely separate things that you can have both or one or the other? Or
I think stress can lead to anxiety. Like stress can trigger anxiety, but just stress doesn't always lead to anxiety. I think it's really dependent on where you're at, the resources that you have, your background, your history, all that kind of stuff. So I think there, like, I have stressful moments, but that doesn't lead to anxiety. Like, I've got a conference next week that I'm speaking to as well that I feel pressured by, it because I want to make sure I'm doing a really good job. I wouldn't say I don't have anxiety about it.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. Absolutely. Absolutely, yeah. It does.
So stage five.
Yeah, yeah. I was going to say we've gone wildly off, but that's fine. Stage five.
So stage five is, I always say this, that it's gotten to the point where your body and your brain have gone, we have given you so many warning signs that you are not coping and you have not done anything about it, so we need to shut down now. And this is where we go into apathy. And this is really quite disastrous for a lot of people. And this is why depression and burnout can sometimes get misdiagnosed. Because apathy is where you, it's not that you don't care. And I think there's a massive misconception around being apathetic, like, oh, they just don't care. It's not that they don't care. It's not that you don't care. So you no longer have the capacity to care because you're so overwhelmed. You're so sort of at the end of your tether that it's like your brain and your body are going, just for self-preservation, we're going to shut down and sort of make it so you can't care for a bit. So just get those, you know, energy resources back up. And that is that's really quite bad for a lot of people, quite scary for a lot of people. So, you know, they start to question themselves. They start to question what they're doing. Are they doing the right thing? Is this, you know, they might have gone from really loving what they're doing to going like, I don't even care about it. And a lot of the times, if they still love it, it's just they can't. Like their body and their brain's just like, no, we warned you enough. Like you're a very unwell person. Let's shut you down for a bit to sort of, you know, regain those resources. And I would say sort of once you've reached that, you're practically at burnout, because then what's going to happen is then it impacts you mentally, right? You can't concentrate, you can't focus, you can't make decisions. You know, there's that really big decline in your mental fortitude. And that is, you know, really important for any professional in the workplace or any human being in the world right now. Yeah. So it is really quite dangerous. But that's a tribe stage six, is obviously burnout.
Yeah, and complete burnout is, I mean, a total inability to do anything.
It's pretty much a really inability to do anything. Like, I mean, I just remember waking up the day where I was like, this is just, I can't. I mean, I woke up with like a cold sore all over my face. It was like a quarter of my face was covered in the cold sore. I genuinely couldn't think clearly. And I just remember laying in bed going like, I know I should get up and have a coffee just to sort of get my day started. I'm like, I just don't even think I physically, mentally, emotionally could even be bothered doing that right now. I just can't do that. It was like, and that went on for, I'm not saying that just happened in like one moment. That happened for days, like weeks. Like it really impacted me.
One of the interesting things that I have thought about, and you mentioned it earlier actually, is stress being a perception. Like it's not a real thing in inverted commas. It's a reaction to a perceived threat, effectively. Yeah. Have you got any thoughts on why people seem to be more stressed, more anxious now than perhaps they were 10, 20 years ago? Or is it that just we're more aware of it now? Now it's more recognised?
Let's go back to the perception of stress and why that's important, because I think there is an element where we've got to understand, we've got to put this into context, because otherwise it's just like nothing's a stress and we don't have to worry about anything.
I mean, I guess that's where I'm coming from is,
yeah,
we must perceive, or people perceive threat everywhere now, seems to be. I don't know.
Yes. So when we were hunter and gatherers, if we think about it, if we're walking down a path and we see a lion, tiger or a bear because we're in the Wizard of Oz all of a sudden, you know, we want to have that automatic physiological response to that perceived threat so we can prime our bodies to run away or fight that potential threat, right? We don't want to consciously figure out if it is a threat. We want to know what then happened was, let's say then we heard, before we saw that lion, tiger or bear, we heard a rustling in the bush and we then associated, okay, a rustling in the bush, that could mean there's a lion, tiger or bear behind that. I'm going to prime my body to run away or fight that potential threat because that's really important.
Yep.
Which makes evolutionary sense. Like, we do need this stress response because it is literally built into our brains. Like, we have a built-in part of our brains that that actually says be very aware of your surroundings so you can survive. It is our survival method.
Yeah.
Fast forward to modern-day society. We are very rarely in a situation where we're running away from lions, tigers, or bears. So having that, like that pure fight or flight response doesn't really make as much sense. I mean, we still need it because obviously we don't live in a crimeless world. We don't live in a world where nothing can kill us.
Yeah, yeah, sure.
We still need it. But the dilemma that we've got right now is that our life has become so much more complicated. And so instead of just having that sort of, you know, baseline of like what we need, you know, we need warmth, we need shelter, we need food, water, all that kind of jazz. We've now got the ways to have those things is we now have to work for those things and those and work, our workplaces have definitely changed. And so it is a bit more complicated, I would say. The financial instability of a lot of people right now is a massive reason to be stressed out, because without financial stability, you can't have shelter, you can't have warmth, you can't have water, you can't have all that kind of stuff. So there is a real threat there and there is a real perception there. However, I do think that where we've sort of gone, and definitely social media probably played a bit of a part of this, is creating that scarcity mindset that there is so much more things to be stressed and worried about, and we can feel more powerless around it.
Yeah.
Stress can either be something that can make you feel powerless, but when you feel stressed out, it's being able to find your own power and looking at what you can do about it. And that comes back down to that personal responsibility and that personal accountability of choosing how you want to do it. And don't get me wrong, you do need to make sure that you're, you know, having a job and you're working and all that kind of stuff. And maybe you're in a company and this is happening to thousands, probably millions of people around the world right now, which is they're stuck in a job that they don't like, that might, they may be in a toxic environment and there's not much they can do about it because there's not as many jobs around. You know, you've got people applying for jobs left, right, and center, really hard to get new jobs. But the dilemma with that then is you can feel like you're stuck in this toxic work environment and you can't escape it. And then you can end up becoming so overwhelmed and so stressed out about it that you don't do what you can do to sort of manage yourself in that situation. And I think a lot of people are feeling powerless right now to make decisions and choices because they're looking at like, well, I just want to quit and live on a beach. It's like, yeah, well, a lot of us do, but we can't do that. So we've got to find, well, what can you realistically do? And I think that's something that we need to talk about. So the perception of stress is like, I always see it as like I'm a very visual person. It's like going into a room and like cementing all the windows and the doors shut, thinking like, well, this is what it is. I can't do anything about it. It's like, what's one thing you can take control of? What's one thing you can do? Because stress makes you feel like you're out of control. Well, how can you gain control in that situation?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, you've got a job you hate. Well, what else can you do about it? Could you maybe not engage in the toxicity? Could you ask to change teams? Could you, you know, we've all had that toxic manager. I've had a toxic manager and I just didn't take them seriously. Easier said than done. I'm not saying that it is that way, but, you know, there's definitely things we've got to look at. But I do think that perception of stress and resilience is not there. And a lot of companies are right now struggling to find that. Well, how can I hold you accountable and create expectations with people talking about stress and anxiety? And that's a very big topic that I'm working with a lot of companies with right now as well.
Okay. I want to come on to how you do take control and some of the methods of how we do that to finish this off. But before I do that, I've been curious as to whether, in your experience and the people you've working with, whether there is a significant difference between men and women encountering high stress and burnout, and is there a difference in age groups, anything that you have noticed?
What we find, if we look at the statistics that I think it was Deloitte put out, don't hold me on Deloitte, it was either Deloitte or Gallup, there is a difference between men and women. So women typically will report higher levels of burnout than men. And there's a whole bunch of reasons for that. The age groups that we're seeing is sort of the older men. So for instance, the 40 to 50 year olds are starting to feel a little bit more stressed and burnt out.
Yep.
And whether that's because there's an awareness now going like, I actually just can't keep doing this because like now my health is starting to fail me and, you know, this isn't going the way I want it to. I will say there's a very big difference between how men and women will deal with it. If women see a problem, they're more likely to deal with it quicker than men if they can.
Yes.
Whereas men are more likely to bury it and go, I don't want to deal with that. like, I don't want to see whatever, you know, there's the old, you know, the whole conversation we've been talking about mental health and men's mental health for the last 10 years, which is great and I love it. But we all know, you know, men are less likely to have those conversations, and they're less likely to speak up, then more likely to not want to tell people that they're not coping.
Yeah.
And I think that definitely something that I've personally seen. And when I first came into this industry, I was like, I'm going to work with women and help them and you know, build, you know, and I love doing that. Don't worry, I do have my women clients. But I seem to get a lot more men going, like, I'm really not coping and I have no idea what to do. I don't want to tell anyone about it. Can you help me? And so I've got, you know, a lot of male clients, and I've worked with a lot of male clients over the last 6-7 years doing this. And there's definitely a difference between my men and my women clients. Like, my guy clients, it takes them 6 sessions to really tell me everything that's going on. I'm like, I always know they're holding back. I'm like, we'll get there. 6 sessions. We'll unlock it all. But my women clients are more likely to say, this is a problem. How do I do it? And it's just how to support those people. But that's something that I find really interesting for myself.
Do you think that is or could be a symptom of men perhaps getting more burned out in the workplace and women getting more burned out outside the workplace?
No. So women, the most burnt out people in society right now are working mums. That's just
okay.
It. So it is working mums. So the dilemma that you've got, and this is why I say burnout isn't always a workplace issue, because let's say you take a working mum, and let's say she's taking on all the responsibility of the household and working, because that's something that else is happening right now, is that, you know, when women entered the workplace, they were still in charge of taking care of the kids. Historically, this is no shade to men. I know a lot of you are doing some brilliant work out there, and I worked with brilliant clients that, you know, there is a really good equal sharing there. So I think what we're seeing right now is that women are more likely to look for a solution over men, because it's kind of, I mean, think about it. Stress has been normalized to the point where we think we don't have to do anything about it.
Yes.
And that's a huge problem. Whereas women are less tolerant to that. They're more likely to talk to their friends, and they're more likely to say, like, this is screwed up. I don't know what to do. Whereas guys are like, yeah, it is what it is. Let's just get on with it. Like, stress is a part of everyday life. It's like, well, yeah, it is, but that doesn't mean you don't do anything about it.
Yeah, that makes perfect sense. A lot of this seems to be about self-awareness.
Yeah.
So, if you can develop that self-awareness about yourself, probably in men's case, and not just bury things away. And let's say you've identified that you are feeling stressed.
Mm-hmm.
On that 1 to 6 scale, you can identify yourself as a 2 or a 3 or whatever it is. What are some of the key things that we should be doing to manage stress on a daily basis to stop that escalation?
Yeah. So my philosophy is I have the 3-pillar approach. And so the first pillar is building up your physical resilience. And that's the first stage that you have to start with. And when we're talking about physical resilience, it's just what I call the common sense basis, which it seems like it's not as common sense right now, but making sleep a priority. That's your first foundation. You've got to, like, make sure sleep is a priority. Now, a lot of people will say to me, yeah, but I'm stressed and anxious, I can't get to sleep.
Okay, cool.
Well, then let's create an environment where you can get a good night's sleep. And so that kind of tips into that mental resilience piece, which is, let's manage that stress and anxiety so you can get that good night's sleep. So that's the first thing, creating really good habits that are really, then what I call the quick wins, where you're going to feel a little bit better. Because like I said, stress has such a profound impact on the body. It will drain your energy like nothing else. So if you can get enough sleep, if you can do some kind of movement that matches where you're at. So this is something that's really important to understand. If you are 100% burnt out, you can't go into the gym and think that you're going to smash some weights around. Like, that's just not physically realistic. So it's understanding where you're physically at and what you can realistically do right now with the resources that you've got. So could you do some stretching? Could you do some walking? Could you go into your garden and just get some fresh air? Like, something that involves some kind of movement that disconnects you from technology, sort of, so you can sort of increase that self-awareness. So that's one thing. Also, making sure you're eating healthy. I am a nutritionist. I can't pretend like food isn't an element in here. You know, eating healthy foods, drinking enough water. You'd be completely surprised at how dehydration can actually trigger stress and anxiety. So having enough water, all that kind of stuff. They're the really simple wins that you can start to implement every single day. So, like, disconnect from technology, get enough sleep, get outside in nature, eat healthy, get me, like all the things we know that are good. What you have to realize though, and this is where we kind of get to the second pillar, which is building resilient mindset. You have to start to recognize what are the barriers for you to do that.
Okay.
And so if there's a barrier for you to get a good night's sleep, what is that? And looking at how to resolve that. What's your barrier from eating healthy, overcoming that? What's your barrier to exercise, overcoming that? So there's that really massive self-awareness piece that has to come into play, which is really understanding what is that. And sometimes it is stress. Stress will genuinely create really bad habits. So for instance, when you're really stressed out, you might feel like you want to scroll on your phone a lot more. You might want to disengage. You might want to escape a lot more. And recognizing those habits and doing something about that, which is then going to open up that space to sort of do all the physical resilience stuff. So that's
those habits you're talking about, they're obviously going to be very individual to each person.
Oh, 100%. Oh, 100%.
But the key to it is knowing how you react to that so that you notice, shit, I am scrolling. I've spent an hour scrolling. I know that's a trigger or warning sign, whatever.
I would say the symptom. And also it's like a freaking vicious cycle because you're stressed and anxious. So you're trying to escape. And then you go on social media and you start comparing yourself to Joe Bloggs, who's got I built $1 million this month. It's like, that's not real. So it's like, let's not compare ourselves to, you know, those people.
Yeah.
So it's all individual. So it's really understanding what your bad habits are. So it could be like staying in bed longer than you thought you were going to, or eating unhealthy, like really understanding those habits. The second pillar that we have to focus on is building that resilient mindset. And that comes down to that really big that changing perception of stress mindset piece, which is, how do you deal with stress? How do you react to stress? And how could we make that a little bit better? So therefore you're able to, you know, be more resilient, but also manage stress in a more efficient and effective way. Now, I always ask this when I do my public speaking, which is like, raise your hands if you were ever sat down and told, this is what stress is, this is why it exists, this is what you can do to manage it better. And everyone's like, absolutely not. Like, I was never taught that. Like, no. And so that's the biggest problem, right? As adults, we have to undo all the coping mechanisms that we created, because we've all created them, regardless of what situation is. Like, how you deal with stress has been created over a lifetime. So you might have to like look back and go, is that a really great way to deal with it? So yeah, like, but there's also coping mechanisms that we've created that worked really well in a situation, but don't work well in the long term. So for instance, like burying your emotions or burying that thought or whatever it is. Because maybe in that moment, it's like, it's not appropriate for me to share. Or maybe you were in an environment that wasn't safe for you to share your feelings or whatever it was. So therefore, it did keep you safe in that moment. But right now, it's not serving a purpose. So being able to undo that and break that is really important. So that's the second pillar, which is, that's probably where I do most of my work with a lot of my clients, is understanding how they think, how their belief systems get in the way of managing stress, and how can we sort of create a better foundation for them to manage their stress more effectively. But again, that comes down to that self-awareness piece.
Yeah.
And then the third pillar is sort of, because I work with a lot of business owners, but I do work with a lot of employees as well who are wanting to sort of work better in the workplace, which is what I call building resilient businesses. But that also kind of couples in with, how can you be resilient within business? So how can you, you know, create habits and foundations that are sustainable for you to maintain your physical, mental, and emotional well-being while working? Or if you're building a business, how can you build a resilient business that you don't respond to stress and it kind of derails everything? So that's sort of the three pillars. But I think for anyone that's listening right now, if you're finding that you're extremely burnt out, really focus on building up those really good habits, things that you can get those quick wins, that you're going to see those. You know, if you get a good night's sleep, makes a world of difference, because you've got to think about sleep as it's a physical, mental, and emotional regulator. So if you get enough sleep, we can regulate all those things. So that's definitely things to think about.
Okay. Is there one thing that you would say to someone? It's probably different depending on where you are, but one thing that allows you to take control of your mental health, of stress, anxiety, that everyone should kind of be doing?
Yeah, it comes down to that self-awareness piece. And so I always have this one exercise, if I can leave anyone with anything, is every single morning before you do absolutely anything, ask yourself, how am I doing? And it's the simplest way to do that is from 0 to 10, how am I doing today? And 10 being I'm doing amazing, 0, I'm really exhausted. And if you are an 8 or under, ask yourself, what is one thing I can do today that would get me a little bit closer to that? We can look at all the reasons why you're at a 3, but that's just going to make you feel like you can't take the power back. But if you ask yourself, what is one thing I can do today that's realistic, that I can action today, that's going to get me a little bit closer to a 10? What is that one thing? And that one thing could be, I need to just have 5 minutes of quiet. It doesn't have to be like, you know, crazy amount of things. Like, I get all my clients, if you guys want to do this, do it, where you write a list of all the things that bring you happiness, alleviate stress, anything like that. And I always say, write a list of things that you can do that take 5 minutes up to 60 minutes, because we all have 5 to 60 minutes in the day to give to ourselves. If we don't, that's the first habit you've got to find, is where can I steal my pocket of 5 minutes to give to myself? Write all that down and action that one thing, because we don't know what we don't know. If I was checking in with myself before I burnt out, the 2 times that I burnt out, I mean, I was young and I was dumb. So hopefully the people that are listening that are middle-aged men, you're not young and you're not a 20-year-old thinking you're invincible. But if I did that, I would have recognized something's not. And I would have probably been able to find the support that I needed. But I waited until I was literally like, I was tapped out and I really needed help. So that would be my advice.
I hope you found today's show insightful. You can connect with Katie and get a free stress score at gystwellbeing.com. If you found the show useful, please tell someone who you think might benefit from listening. You can also sign up to the Middleman newsletter, which is an article and resources based on the theme of the week's show, at middlemanpodcast.com. Next week, we're talking to a midlife man who's on a very similar path of discovery as me.
I felt like it was a midlife response to me not coping with life. It was only as I started speaking to more people, it was only then I realised that maybe this trauma may have played a part in it. I didn't see it as the reason for the unsettled to start with.
See you then.